Lights, camera, action. Welcome back to Flick Flash. As you would expect, nuclear professionals are eagerly anticipating the release of Oppenheimer, not only to watch Cillian Murphy, but also to see how much the film got right and incorrect about this key nuclear event. I'll evaluate two main topics. While many may correct or commend the film's scientific and technical accuracy, does the film portray J. Robert Oppenheimer in affected communities? Nuclear problems have neglected the stories of Manhattan Project victims. I may be stupid to expect a $100 million Hollywood picture to give the whole tale, but Christopher Nolan should. If Dunkirk is any indicator, some of the most affected populations will be omitted from the story. Nolan could acknowledge the uranium workers in the Navajo Nation and Belgian Congo and nuclear test Downwinders to complete the cinematic picture. Unnamed Miners. Uranium, which is mined for nuclear weapons, was essential to the Manhattan Project. El Dorado, Shinkalabwe, and Colorado Plateau mines provided the Manhattan Project. Miners' health suffered from these mines' uranium extraction, which led to political murder and civil war in Congo. The Manhattan Project consumed 14% of Colorado Plateau Navajo uranium. From the late 1940s through the mid-1960s, Navajo miners mined over 4 million tons of uranium ore, according to FASS. Navajo miners were unknowingly exposed to radiation while earning minimal pay. According to FASS, they became the most severely exposed group of workers to ionizing radiation in the U.S. nuclear weapons complex, with high rates of lung cancer, while the U.S. government deliberately kept them in the dark about the health implications. As early as 1942, scientists tried to expose the consequences of radiation on miners, but some were prevented from publishing. The Department of Energy released a late 1940s paper in 1994 that revealed the government's awareness of radiation effects and the main reason for hiding it from miners. The study states, "We can see the possibility of a shattering effect on the morale of the employees if they become aware that there was substantial reason to question the standards of safety under which they are working." This study might boost radiation-related workplace injury claims if labor unions use it to support extra hazardous pay demands. If Nolan wants to paint the fullest cinematic picture, he should include nods to the Navajo Nation and Belgian Congo uranium miners and the downwinders of nuclear testing. In August 1939, Albert Einstein wrote to Franklin D. Roosevelt about the prospect of an atom bomb. In his letter to Roosevelt, Einstein highlighted the need for uranium and pointed Roosevelt to Congo. "The U.S. has only very poor uranium ores in moderate quantities," he stated. "Canada and the former Czechoslovakia have excellent ore, but the Belgian Congo has the most uranium." The Manhattan Project relied on uranium from the Colorado Plateau and the El Dorado mine in Canada, but the Shinkalabwe mine in Belgian Congo made it feasible. The Shinkalabwe mine has the world's richest uranium resources, up to 7,000 times greater than U.S. uranium ore. Congo became a Cold War proxy after the mine supplied two-thirds of the Manhattan Project's uranium. Congolese workers labored for Belgian employers and American consumers in the same risky conditions as the Navajo miners, unaware of the health risks and end product of their labor. Miners and their families reported major health difficulties, presumably due to radiation exposure, but none knew of their Manhattan Project participation. After World War II, U.S. authorities, including Manhattan Project Director Lieutenant General Leslie Groves, feared Nazi Germany or the Soviet Union would uncover Shinkalabwe. After the U.S. bombed Japan, the Canadian uranium mine was credited, not Shinkalabwe. Prime Minister Patrice Lumumba led Congo to independence on June 30, 1960. U.S. authorities worked with Belgium, the U.K., and the Belgian mine owner to provide practically all of Shinkalabwe's uranium to the U.S. and U.K. during the Manhattan Project. Lumumba stated after his election that he would not allow the U.S. to dominate Congo's uranium like Belgium did. After being rejected by the U.S., Lumumba went to the Soviet Union for help when Katanga, which included Shinkalabwe, seceded on July 11, 1960. On January 17, 1961, Eisenhower authorized the CIA to murder Lumumba out of concern. After a four-year civil war, the CIA installed Joseph Mobutu as Congo's leader. Mobutu was ruler until 1997. Fallout Path. Oppenheimer will show a non-CGI reconstruction of the Trinity test, which took place in Alamogordo, New Mexico, on July 16, 1945. The Manhattan Project stated that ammunition and pyrotechnics triggered the explosion. New Mexico and neighboring populations were not advised about the Trinity test, evacuated, or warned of fallout health risks to protect secrecy. In 1947, the Manhattan Project's radiation safety chief's assistant informed a worried healthcare professional that the safety and health of the people at large is not in any way endangered after a troubling rate of newborn death downwind of the test. The New Mexico Health Department reported that the newborn mortality rate was 38% higher in 1945 than in 1946 and 57% higher than in 1947. Downwinders of the Trinity test and the 100 atmospheric nuclear tests. at the Nevada test site from 1951 to 1992 were called Downwinders. This group has reported heart disease, leukemia, and other malignancies without a family history. They've fought the US government for radiation compensation for almost 70 years. The 1990 Radiation Exposure Compensation Act offers one-time payments to persons who have been diagnosed with cancer owing to radiation exposure from nuclear testing or uranium mining. Radiation victims have reasonable criticisms of the act since it primarily applies to a restricted range of afflicted locations, leaving many downwinders ineligible for compensation. Given the Trinity test's poor data collection, RECAS demanding bar of evidence leaves many victims uncompensated. Not just Oppenheimer. These communities' tales should be recounted alongside the bomb makers. Finally, how Oppenheimer is depicted will be important to me and you. Notice how the film wants you to feel about him. Is he a genius, leader, or important person? Are we supposed to see his mental anguish after producing nuclear weapons and leave the theater thinking of him as a morally ambiguous man? Should we pardon him? With this information in preparation, you should be able to view Oppenheimer more closely to determine if Nolan tells the whole tale. Thank you once again for being a part of Flick Flash. Until next time, keep watching, keep exploring, and keep that movie and TV magic alive. Don't forget to subscribe, like, and stay tuned for more exciting recaps. This is Flick Flash, signing off.